Hello and welcome back to my channel, which is dedicated to philosophy, music and art in general. So, fiction, literature, romance, poetry always comes into contact with philosophy and interacts with it in an indirect or direct way. And if this literature belongs to the so-called beautiful epoch, La Belle Époque, that is, by the beginning of the 20th century and the end of the 19th century, it can also be a godsend for the philosophy of art. For example, the novels of Marcel Proust are filled with so many references to the most diverse works of art from different times, epochs, different styles, you know, that they can literally serve as a guide to the artistic life of the most different eras. Marcel Proust, his personality and time of his life. He was born 1872 and was dead 1822, and he was a Parisian, a native of a medical family. And before the publication of The Search for Lost Time, he was perceived as a dandy and a regular in the aristocratic salons of Paris. He was allowed there thanks to protection of his friends. And this environment to a grand extent formed the body of the seventh volume epic roman. In his youth, Proust was strongly attracted to the works of the English aesthetician and writer John Ruskin. Moreover, Proust tried to translate his works. Although his English was very mediocre, as he had said, Ruskin is the most important figure for the Pre-Raphaelites. That is, Ruskin in his works tells about a kind of singing of the beautiful moments of art, of the past, of the individuality, recreating uniqueness and this individuality throughout the art, capturing them in works of art, you know. And this is also a very important concept for the In Search for Lost Time, where the author finds the meaning of living in art. Spiritual monuments of the past allow you to find this lost time in his context, maybe. Also, Proust is read by Honoré de Balzac, Chateaubriand, de Vigny, Baudelaire, Dostoevsky, Tolstoy. At the same time, Proust doesn't consider himself as a decadent. A letter to Daniel Halévy from 1882, for example, can be mentioned in this context. And he doesn't accept Mallarmé, Verlaine, for example, and the same, however, recalled that already at the Lyceum, Proust made a strange impression with his incredible tenderness, courtesy, and he was look-alike a restless angel. So, Swann's Way, several years had passed since the death of his mother, to whom Proust had been so painfully attached. He lives in his apartment in Paris, in walls covered with cork, which do not let in the noises and smells of the outside world. And he suffers from asthma, sleeps during the day, works at night, very messy, irregular person, to tell the truth. And when the first part of his huge prose masterpiece was completed in 1812-1813, he didn't find a publisher for it. Even the best critics puzzled by the long sentences and complicated poetic style were unable to accept a new view of the world that required no new means of expression and new ways of expression. In 1830, Proust managed to publish this roman, this first part, the novel's one's way. However, published in the first edition in 1813, the book remained almost unnoticed. The profound shock of Proust's personal life in 1814, the death in an accident of his secretary Alfred Agostinelli, as well as the delay of in publication due to the war, led to a significant change in the plot of the novel, and it was a really difficult period of time for Proust. So, three nerve-wracking parts of the novel, which were called Cambrai, Swann's Love, or Love of Swann, and Names of Lands, the name. The first part contains the textbook Proust Madeleine. It's the most important and the most popular, maybe, piece of this roman, a piece of sponge cake and a cup of tea offered by the mother to the adult narrator. And from this small event, all the further lace fabric, lace creature of endless memories, associations and sensations grows up. And the famous description of the process of falling asleep, which was so criticized by the publisher Ollendorf, almost 30 pages takes this description. Time here is just interpreted in the Bergsonian way, you know. Bergsonian sense of duration, la durée, residence, and as it were recessing the process of counting of time, counting this time. Hence the painful experiences of the child due to the need to break away from his mother, dreams, so he describes it as during sleep a person keeps around himself the thread of hours, the order of years and months and worlds, even worlds. Psychologism and automatism of the languages of everyday life, at the same time colored in some sweet poetic feeling. And by the way, for me, as for a musician, it's very important mention. The Sonata of Fantoil is a character no less important than the narrator or Swann or his mistress Adetta de Crécy. It's a short musical phrase that becomes the trigger that causes love sickness or love longing in for Swann. And this phrase was very poetically described. So as the airy, peaceful wafting, like a fragrance, it's a very Parisian atmosphere, I think. And this melody flew, having reached a certain limit and withstood a second pause, it turned sharply and already at a different pace, accelerated, frequent, dreary, continuous, joyful, drew Swann to unknown distances. And not only Swann, I think, but also many other people. Adet is an extremely multifaceted character. On the one hand, she is a flat and spoiled cocotte. She is a formerly courtesan, a Philistine with a pretension. On the other hand, in the mind of Swann, and it's very important, just look for the chorus Salome, or any other female image. What hypertrophied luxury, this thick color and precious richness and all these gems, all this jewelry. On the other hand, she looks like Sephora, the daughter of a biblical king from the fresco of the Sistine Chapel by Botticelli. And one day Moses had to flee from Egypt to the land of Midian, and he was sitting by the well, where the daughters of Jethro had brought their father's sheep. Other sheepherds appeared and chased the girls away to water their flock first, and Moses helped the girls and watered their flock. And the moral of the calling of Moses, that an angelic purity in her face and in her face, in these lines. And at the end, the adult narrator who admires Madame Swann, what an angelic purity of her face, and Madame Swann walking through the Bois de Boulogne, Park of Boulogne, as a work of art come to life, you know, and her violets on her chest and her toilet outlook, I don't know exactly how it should better to say. Swann may be narrator's alter ego, I think. And Swann's mental lethargy and laziness are constantly emphasized by author. At the same time, this intoxicating, overwhelmed passion for Adet is as a recreation for his personality, maybe. A woman who wasn't his type at all, and she became his wife. By the way, the moment of marriage is omitted by the author. We don't know how it had happened. We are simply faced with the fact that it took place. And in the future, the narrator himself falls under the spell of the daughter of Adet and Swann, Gilbert. And the philosophy of the name, which is outlined of the last part, it allows us to fix our attention on the verbal expression. It's very significant part, I think. Verbal expression of all the sensual diversity that is carried before us on the page and in life, of course. And here perhaps there is already the path that leads to the acquisition of meaning and time in the seventh volume. So each city draws a number of associations for narrator. I'm not finding in the name of Florence, for example, the parts of which cities are usually composed. He was forced to recreate a certain fabulous city by fertilizing which spring scents that he thought was the essence of Giotto's genius. That this short skiz, this short and incomplete attempt, or just a collection of my impressions, were useful for you, maybe. And thank you for your attention, and see you again. All good to you. Bye.